Okay, so let's start with the academy use cases that we'll be covering for the next 4 days. So we will be using the COVID-19 digital packages for our exercises and the demonstrations that we will do. The details of these packages are given in the next set of slides in the resources. So you can have a look at that, where you can find the further information. And through this presentation, we'll give an overview of the DHIS2 models that will be used during the academy through these packages that we'll discuss. So the COVID-19 packages for DHIS2 had the following models which are available. So there were packages released in discussion with the team at WHO Geneva based on the COVID reporting guidelines. So there was an aggregate package, which was daily reporting forms for COVID cases. There was an events package, which was for outbreak line listing. If the country did not have the resources to track individual COVID case, then they had the option to maintain a consolidated line list of the person details and all the information they wanted to collect for that specific person and the outcome of that respective COVID case at the end of 14 days. So there was a mechanism to add it as events as well. Then we had a port of entry screening and follow-up package to implement at different port of entries, which could be your airports, your land borders, your sea borders, or ports, etc. There were two key modules available for case-based surveillance and laboratory information and contact tracing. So in this particular course, we will have a look at the two key programs, the case-based surveillance and laboratory and the vaccine registry. And the programs which are in shaded regions, they will be used for support, okay, for various custom web apps that I mentioned in the beginning, that we'll be having a look at these web apps as well. So the main programs that you will be looking at would be the case-based surveillance and laboratory information program and the vaccination registry program. So just to quickly take you through to the surveillance work, the workflow which was used in the case-based surveillance program. So a patient attends a health facility and he's screened and identified as a suspect COVID-19 case. Based on that, he is either hospitalized or put into isolation and receives the treatment, and the details are filled in the case reporting form. In case the patient is not hospitalized, doesn't need hospitalization, then again the details are filled into the case reporting form. For that suspected case, a lab request is made to confirm whether the person who has arrived at the health facility is a confirmed COVID case or not. The lab result, which comes out as a result of the lab request, determines if the case is confirmed, and the details are filled into the case reporting form. In case the person turns out to be a positive case, then the follow-up is conducted on that respective case with the respective outcomes, which were not recovered, recovered, and death. So in any of these three scenarios, the necessary information is filled for that respective patient. In case the person has recovered, then whether the person needed hospitalization, then we add information for the discharge. And in case the person was not hospitalized, then we add the required details. And everything is summarized at the end as an outcome of the patient's encounter at the health facility, depending upon the case history, the test results, and the hospitalization details of that specific patient. So based on this workflow, the program, the package was designed. So we'll have a look at that specific package in our demonstrations. And the same package or the same programs will be used by you to do various ungraded and graded exercises. So this is the basic of the case-based surveillance program, which has been developed and could be used, will be used for the different sessions moving ahead. So now how the workflow was converted into a DHIS2 data model. So we had the first step as the enrollment, which had the basic registration details of the case, such as the date of symptoms onset, the case attributes, such as case ID, date of birth, sex, the number of contacts, whatever he could recall in the past few days. So that information was captured as part of the registration. Then there were four stages in this program. So basically four events, which were of both repeatable and non-repeatable nature. So when we talk about these property of repeatable and non-repeatable, is anything which is non-repeatable, that event will happen only one time. So those details will be captured once. If an event is repeatable, that means that event or that service could be given to patient multiple times. So you can create different instances of that specific event or that specific service depending upon patient to patient. So stage one, which you see here, was to collect the clinical history, the examination, and the diagnosis of that respective patient. So within this respective stage, we were capturing the clinical signs and symptoms. So all the classic symptoms of COVID-19, and as new systems were introduced, were found out, new symptoms, they were also added to the list. Then in case of the female cases, you were capturing details of pregnancy, collecting information for any underlying disease, which the person has already is aware of, the details of hospitalization, the risk of exposure, and the travel history were collected in this respective stage. So this was a one-time event where all the information was captured based on the initial screening and information which was gathered from the patient for these respective areas. Then stage two was a repeatable program stage. Hence, you see a repeatable icon here. So for a person, it is possible that multiple lab requests could be taken for multiple sample collections. There were scenarios where the first time test results did not come out to be positive or indeterminate. So again, new lab requests were to be generated for getting a repeat test. So within the lab request form, we were supposed to enter the reason for testing for COVID-19. What kind of samples were being collected, whether they were nasal samples or throat samples or any other type of samples which were used to confirm a COVID-19 case. And the details of the test request were added in the lab request program stage. So depending upon the number of times the test was required for a specific patient, the same number of times the lab request event or the program stage has to be generated. Stage three was lab results. That too was repeatable. So for each request which was added for the COVID-19 test, a corresponding lab result stage or form was added, which had information on the test results. And based on the information collected in stage one, two, and three, the health outcome was notified at the end of 14 days, which was a normal cycle for the virus, with the health outcome, the release details, and the summary of the contacts which were traced for that respective individual. So this was the DHIS2 data model, which was configured for the COVID case surveillance and laboratory investigations program. Then we had a follow-up program for COVID-19 contact registration and follow-up. So all the contacts mentioned by this respective case were enrolled in the system one by one. And they were linked through the relationships functionality. We'll not be reviewing the entire program for the COVID-19 contact registration and follow-up. We'll have a look at how the relationship between the index cases identified here and the contacts identified here was used to see the tracing of the contacts with the index. So we'll see how custom web apps were used through this particular relationship between the index case and the respective contacts for COVID. So for that specific context, we'll have a look at the COVID-19 contacts program, but our main program would be the COVID-19 case surveillance program. The broad system design document, which was documented for dissemination to all the implementations, is given here in the presentation. So the material for today would be available on Moodle. So you could have a look at the presentation and the system design document if you want to learn more on how the program was configured for the COVID-19 surveillance and laboratory investigation use case. So So for the contact registration and follow-up program, the workflow was the patient attends the facility, and after the screening, the details of all the contacts were taken from that respective patient, and the contacts were registered into the system, and follow-up was conducted. If the contact was identified as a potential COVID-19 case, then the contact was made to attend the facility. And if the contact was not identified as a potential COVID-19 case, the contact was cleared. So based on this workflow, the program was designed. In addition to the COVID case surveillance program, the contacts were also identified through the ports of entry program. So if through the ports of entry, if the person who was entering that specific geography or country was identified with COVID-19 symptoms, then the contact history was also taken from them, and all the person who were identified as potentially exposed to that respective person were again screened and registered into the system to mark their status as potential positives or not a potential COVID-19 case, and then their outcomes are mentioned as whether they need hospitalization or COVID-19 care, or whether they were released as COVID negative cases. So again, you had the enrollment here where we were capturing details of the contact as well. Then we had two stages. One was the follow-up stage and one was the symptom stage. The follow-up stage took the relationship with the case, so how the case and the contact are related, and in what circumstances the contact might have come in vicinity of the index case. So details were taken for those. Then in the symptoms, there were clinical signs and symptoms taken for each contact, and then necessary follow-up visits were made to find out whether the person has encountered COVID-19 because of his being in close vicinity with the COVID-19 case, which has been already identified or is under the process of lab testing. So then necessary details were captured at the time of follow-ups, and then an outcome was given to the contacts as well. So any contact who was identified as a COVID positive case then itself became an index case for the COVID surveillance and laboratory testing program, and a similar contact tracing exercise would have been conducted for that patient, and the data would have been entered accordingly. So the cycle goes in this way, as we are already aware of how things were used for the contact tracing mechanisms under the COVID-19 pandemic. Then we have the COVID-19 vaccination workflow. Those a patient attends a vaccination status for their first or second dose. Now, different countries implemented different mechanisms. Some of them did self-registration, some of them did pre-registrations by default of all their eligible population, depending upon their databases, which are available in country for the eligible population. So depending upon the initial point of entry, the workflows differed. But the default workflow, which we'll discuss in our presentations or sessions in next 4 days, would be that a person would be visiting a vaccination site or a vaccination station or a health facility for getting their COVID-19 vaccine dose. And the person would register the person or search for that specific person through any of the identifiers which are nationally available in country, which are being used and have the maximum coverage. The clinician notes any underlying conditions which the person already has. And then there is a pre-immunization question where you take details of their past history with COVID-19, if it exists. So then that's the section which is filled next. Once the pre-immunization section is filled, then the clinician proceeds with the vaccination and registers the dose. In case during the observation period, the person reports any adverse events, then a note is made of that. So the details are captured there for the adverse event. And the next event or the next date when the second dose is scheduled, depending upon the vaccine candidate which was being implemented in country, the date of next visit was defined, and SMS notifications were also configured as part of the default package, where we could remind the person to come for the second reminder for their second dose at the same health facility or vaccination site where they got their first dose. A similar document for the immunization registry for COVID-19 is available and given as a resource. You can review the document to get more information on what were the considerations and how the program was configured for use for COVID-19 vaccination. So in terms of the DHIS2 data model, similar to the COVID case registration that we saw, we had an enrollment where we discussed the main patient identifiable information for the case. And then we had the discuss the data collection on underlying conditions, the pre-immunization questions, and the vaccination. The vaccination stage itself was a repeatable stage. So you schedule another stage for the second dose, and whatever information was required to be carried forward from the first event to the second event, then those program rules or algorithms are already configured, and the person had to fill the only the necessary details at the time of the second dose. So this is how the program was set up. So the resources which are available for further getting updates on the packages which were done are given on this respective link. You can visit. This would redirect you to the documentations page on the DHIS2 website where all the documentation is available. There were specific webinars done for COVID-19 surveillance and COVID-19 vaccination packages to introduce these packages to the community. So the YouTube links are given here in the presentation. Once you have access to the Moodle platform, you can review the presentations and also have a look at the YouTube videos to get detailed information how these packages were designed for use across different countries. So this was my last slide, giving you a basic overview of the Academy use cases. So we'll take a break for 5 minutes, and then we'll start with an overview of the DHIS2 instance that you will be using and we will be using for demonstrations and exercises for the next days in the Academy. And we'll also give an overview of the Moodle platform.